Today, moderating this roundtable is Mr. David Marchick. Mr. Marchick is the managing director of the Carlyle Group and is a nationally renowned expert on foreign investment and national security issues. Mr. Marchick, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. People can hear. This will be a very interesting and hopefully educational and hopefully entertaining discussion. I promised my panelists that I would surprise them with some questions, so it's not going to be totally pre-rehearsed, and we'll make it interesting. Let me just start off by saying it's an honor to be here. I recently gave a speech at Yale Law School, and I started my speech by saying that I really enjoyed speaking here because I didn't get accepted when I applied. And I feel the same way here because when I was a practicing lawyer for several years in a row, I tried to become the lawyer, the outside advisor for the Committee on 100 and was rejected every year. And so now I feel like I'm finally making it a little, so I appreciate the invitation. Let me introduce the panelists. We have a great panel. We're going to talk about foreign investment, the politics of it, the economics of it. David Fagan, to my left, is a partner at Covington & Burling and leads the practice there dealing with CFIUS, which is the government reviews of foreign investment. He's my former partner, and he's now my lawyer. So he's really, in my view, the leading lawyer in this space and really the go-to person. He graduated from NYU, has a background in national security, and has handled some of the toughest cases of foreign investors seeking to acquire U.S. assets. Michelle, let me get a raise of hands here. How many of you have watched the show Sex and the City? Okay. So Michelle was the Assistant Secretary for Public Affairs and Strategic Development, really one of Hank Paulson's right-hand people during the financial crisis. The thing that I like about her the most was that there was a famous movie called Too Big to Fail that came out after the book, and Miranda from Sex and the City played Michelle. So she has a very distinguished background as an advisor, working at the White House, working at the National Security Council, being involved in the most difficult financial issues that our country has faced since the 1930s. But just remember, Miranda, Sex and the City. Okay, and Daniel Rosen is, I don't have anything funny to say about him.
Nothing funny.
I would say, the leading macroeconomist that covers U.S.-China investment issues. He has written the definitive papers on these issues. He has a consulting firm, advisory firm, that deals with these issues. If you go to the Rhodium Group, you can see details on every Chinese investment in the United States on a state-by-state level, and he really does a fantastic job and is really the preeminent expert on those issues. So let's dive in, starting with Daniel. Maybe you could start by talking about the trends in Chinese investment. Is there a lot? Is it growing? What sectors? What's the outlook?
Thank you, David. It's a pleasure to be here at the Committee of 100 to talk about all this. So it's first thing, this is a relatively new story. We've been talking about trade policy. We've been talking about all sorts of aspects in our economic relationship with China for decades. China's direct investment in our backyard is only about a 3 or 4 year old story at the most. We're just at the very beginning of what will be a long story to come. If you look back at U.S. imports from China in, say, 1990 and compare them to today, like several orders of magnitude different, it's the same story we're starting to see unfold now in terms of direct investment flow. And that's not so much about China becoming unusual as an investor here. It's just China becoming normal, China becoming like the UK or Japan or Canada as a direct investor in the largest economy in the world. When we look at the current trends, they're very important, but we need to remember this is very early days, and it's hard to perfectly extrapolate from what we have thus far. That said, We're putting our first quarter 2013 numbers out probably by the end of next week. They're available publicly on our website. And the things that are notable in the current trend right now is that the flows are on their way up again after a fairly modest fourth quarter of 2012. We'll probably have about $750 million of new deals in the first quarter alone.
$750 million?
Yeah, $750 million. Wanchang, for example, Complete Genomics, and a bunch of others.
But that's tiny in the greater scheme of things, right?
Tiny in the greater scheme of things, absolutely. But it does set up 2013 to probably be another record year, as last year was. A lot of people said, well, it's an election year in the United States last year, leadership change in China, let's not expect big things. But we were close to $6.5 billion last year. Small compared to how much FDI we take in globally, but definitely a big early step in the
what
trend.
Sectors? What
yeah,
are the big
me,
sectors?
Let me mention a few more things that are notable about the numbers we're seeing right now. For the first time in this nascent boom, the past three quarters, we've seen a greater value of investment from Chinese firms by private Chinese companies than state Chinese companies for the first time.
Interesting.
The state firms have been the biggest by value. The private have been the biggest by number, smaller, but lots of smaller private deals. Now the privates are the biggest dollar value, too. We also see the Chinese moving into new sectors, which we've anticipated they'd be moving into more. Higher technology operations becoming the norm. The genomics deal I mentioned is just one of those. And also modern consumer services. We have Baidu setting up cubicles in California for hundreds of new employees as they start to bring their Chinese IT brand into U.S. consumer space. So those are just a couple of the things that are notable in Q1, and I'm sure we'll pull some others out as we go through the hour.
Let me ask one follow-up question. What's been interesting to me about Chinese investment is there's been a lot of manufacturing investment, which is counterintuitive because you would think, well, foreign companies invest in China to get low-cost labor to manufacture products, but what you've seen is Chinese manufacturing companies investing here. Why would they do that?
Absolutely, a great question. You know, and some people would think that when we break down the sectoral distribution of Chinese investment here, we would see something scary, that they were only picking a handful of strategic sectors. In fact, Chinese firms are investing in the United States in every sector where they have had significant growth at home. But they're not just setting up basic labor-intensive manufacturing here. Quite the opposite. They're leaving that in China and coming over here to find the, let's say, four-fifths of the value in a modern manufacturing business that has nothing to do with workers on the shop floor. What Alcoa does that Chinalco does not do is the reason why Chinese firms want to have more of a presence here in the American market.
So, David, you heard Dr. Gao at lunch. He was restrained from the last time I saw him, which was a private conversation. The U.S. government, from the president to the Secretary of State to the Secretary of Treasury, has said, we welcome Chinese investment. Okay? That's our official policy. Do we?
First, let me say, having heard his remarks, I can completely sympathize and empathize with him. And I think anybody who's been through CFIUS can. I think the answer, Dave, to your question is yes, but it's a yes but. Just to throw out one factoid, and then I'm going to throw it back to you and also see what you think on
okay.
this.
This was not part of the agreement, though. So.
I remarked to our panelists before, having done this several times with you, I knew going in that whatever we had agreed on before, it was going to be a new panel, so I'm going to put it back on you. So look, I think the yes, but we are open. The attitude is generally right, and we do want to attract foreign investment, and the macro data, Dan and I have talked a lot about this, supports that. If you look at the big data out there at the macro level, we have a pretty good record about substantiating our open investment policy. Totally open to greenfield investment, notwithstanding some of the harder experiences that some investors have had with CFIUS, the Committee on Foreign Investment in the United States. In fact, most of the deals are approved. Indeed, since from December to February, there were five major Chinese deals approved by CFIUS. Mm. And I understand Mr. Gao had a recent experience that was negative, but if you look at the macro picture, that's 5-2-1. And so when we say we're open to investment at the big policy level, we agree with it, or we can substantiate it. At the same time, there is a but. And the but comes into the details, and it reflects some of the experiences that some investors have had, including CIC in that most recent deal. You know, the CFIUS annual report, every year CFIUS produces an annual report to Congress, and they're usually about a year behind. But one of the things that it includes in there is a statement about the intelligence community assessment on foreign direct investment into the United States. And the most recent report, which came out around December, for the first time said that the intelligence community, the U.S. intelligence community, assessed with a moderate level of confidence that certain foreign governments and certain foreign companies were using M&A activity to try to collect critical technologies to the United States. They didn't name China, but everybody in the press did, and that's who they meant. That, in combination with some other issues, including cybersecurity, has meant that there is sort of a trust but verify approach to our openness to investment from China. It's true that we are open, but at the same time, it is also true that Chinese transactions get closer scrutiny. And U.S. government officials can't really say that, but it's true. That's the reality. You know, I said I would turn it back to you.
Well, let me ask you a question before you ask me a question. So Dan mentioned some sectors.
Yeah.
Okay. What sectors are going to have an easier time getting approval, and what sector is going to have a harder time getting approval from Chinese investors?
Yeah, so let me start with the harder ones, because it's easy to eliminate those and then you have everything else. It's by and large true that the Chinese are investing every place where there's growth. There's a couple of sectors where they're not. They can't really invest in defense in the United States, for example. Leaving defense aside, anything that is connected to our telecommunications infrastructure, anything that is connected to our electric distribution and transmission will be very challenging. Not prohibitive, but challenging. Software transactions where the software can go into systems and assets that are crucial to either the government or to our critical infrastructure. Those sectors, defense will be off limits, telecom will be just about off limits, and software and the grid and the transmission will be very, very tough. Everything else, I think, by and large, is pretty open.
Okay. Michelle, you were in the White House at the time of Dubai ports.
Right.
Okay. Do people here remember the whole Dubai? I know, Min, that we worked together. People remember the whole controversy over Dubai ports? Okay, so that was over a Middle East government buying a port, which was a ridiculous debate, frankly, because there was no security risk.
Right.
How, in your view, you're a press expert, among other things, how has the press covered Chinese investment in the United States, and how has that affected the way that government officials think about Chinese investment and the policy?
Sure. And that was, Dubai Ports was not a Chinese investment, but it was treated similarly. The Washington Press Corps looks for controversy. They're never going to write a story that says, Chinese company X bought American company Y, this is great. They just don't do that.
Right.
They look for controversy, and especially anything that can stir up a political debate in town. And I think that's true on a lot of issues related to China, not just investment. But the reporters who cover Chinese investment in the U.S. look for vulnerabilities always, and they probe for those immediately. And if the Chinese investor isn't prepared to answer that in the first go-round, you start off completely on the wrong foot in this town. CFIUS, the regulators who sit on the committee, are largely immune from politics. I mean, I think they try to separate themselves from politics and look at the facts, but they certainly read every single article that's written, and if the company hasn't answered questions, they'll turn around and ask for more details. And that's not true just of the U.S. press. It's also, we're seeing it more and more in the Chinese press as well, that because we live in a global media market now, so a Bloomberg reporter or a Wall Street Journal reporter in China can write about the acquiring company, and it'll generate follow-up stories over here. The people that can really get spun up over a press story that raises skepticism is, of course, Congress.
Congress, right.
And interest groups. And they often don't care one way or the other about the specific transaction. They just see an opportunity to score some political points and make some progress on their policy agenda. And that's really when it becomes the worst.
So you're saying people in Congress might see opportunity to take political points, so they might take advantage of those?
A123, yeah, you think?
I just want to make sure that's what I heard.
Okay. Never happens.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, A123 was like that. Yeah. That wasn't about the batteries. It was about the Department of Energy's subsidies.
You want to describe the transaction?
Yeah,
this was a controversial transaction that just went through.
That was approved, and I'm not going to say the name of the Chinese company, right?
It's Wangshan.
Wangshan. Thank you. Bid for A123, a battery company in the U.S., that had been subsidized by the Department of Energy to develop new batteries for alternative vehicles. And when the bid was announced, the acquisition was announced, everyone in Congress, the Republicans who had been beating up the White House about Solyndra and about all kinds of other subsidy programs that they didn't like, saw this as yet another opportunity to talk about wasteful spending, that the government had invested all this money in this battery company that then proceeded to go belly up, and now we were handing off the technology to a Chinese investor. So it was not even about that transaction, but there were just a whirlwind of news stories. And once that happens, the companies really lose control of how everyone views
it. So at a macro level, would you say the press has been positive towards Chinese investment, negative, neutral? How would
They'll claim they're neutral,
right?
Because they always do. I think skeptical is probably the word I would use. They look for vulnerabilities, and when they can't find any, the story generally goes away. If they can't get others to echo the concern, but they'll definitely poke around in the first instance.
Dan, you wanted to add something?
Yeah, I just want to add a quick thought on this. You know, David Fagan started his remarks in your provocative question about his reaction to Dr. Gao, by saying he was very sympathetic to everything that Gao Xiqing had to say at lunch. And I am too. But I think part of this issue we're talking about now, whether the U.S. is really open or not, I think it's important that folks on the Chinese side, like Dr. Gao, are sympathetic to why Washington reacts the way it does as well. As I noted before, this is only about a 3 or 4 year old phenomenon of Chinese firms in significant number and values undertaking to make acquisitions and greenfield investments in the United States of America. You can't really expect the United States to be clear on how to react to this secular trend that's going to go from $6 billion last year, maybe 10 this year, maybe $100 billion or $200 billion a year by 2020. That's what our projections would suggest. You can't really blame DC and people with a lot to do and more deals to do every year to know what to do with Chinese firms when the corporate governance structures and the political relationship to the firms is, let's be honest, very different than our own, to say the least, if not sometimes intentionally more opaque than we expect from the way corporate governance is supposed to work. So there's, I think, responsibility on both sides to be sympathetic to the legitimate needs of the other side to make sure that this whole thing unfolds the right way. Because God forbid there was a big security breach of American interests associated with a Chinese investment, it would kill the opportunity to grow this story for a decade to come. Yep. We'd be drawing a thick red line around China, and we wouldn't be able to do as many deals as hopefully we will be able to do. So I think both sides should sort of keep their long-term characterizations of what the other side is up to dry a little bit until we can see what can be done in terms of working through some of the disagreements.
And David, China's not the only country that has some challenges with particular investments, right?
That's right.
And do you want to name any of the other countries that have other challenges?
There are countries that often have challenges. So China, Russia, and then some very close allies of ours also have challenges. French transactions, Israeli transactions in certain sectors have had challenges. We have, CFIUS has blocked a deal from a European NATO ally that was not French. There have been other even Commonwealth country transactions that have been hard. It's not, it truly is a case-by-case approach. So it's not just Chinese transactions. I want to pivot off of two things, though. One thing that Dan said, and then also Michelle. I agree completely with Dan that we should acknowledge the issues both ways. And I think, just as I'm sympathetic to what Dr. Gao said, having lived through some harrowing CFIUS experiences, it can be pretty unpleasant. I think we can do a better job of being more candid and transparent about where the issues may be. At the same time, in the interest of candor, there should be some acknowledgement that there are some legitimate reasons why we might have particular concerns about certain transactions.
And what are those? Give us some examples. Like with China, for example, the whole issue of
cybersecurity
and espionage,
yeah,
is inextricably wound with the security reviews. Is that correct?
That's completely correct. And we are starting to see this now more from the U.S. government, where there had been trickles over the last couple of years about our concerns on the cybersecurity front. And it's not just directed at cyber espionage with respect to U.S. government systems. It's about industrial espionage with respect to U.S. businesses. And there's been a policy shift. They're now very public about it. That is a legitimate issue. And, you know, sitting where I sit, which is spending a lot of time trying to ensure that good transactions can get through, but the other part of my practice is national security based and cybersecurity based, and I spend a lot of time counseling clients that have been hacked, and there's not really a question about where that's coming from and what's being stolen. And that is something that I think both sides need to get out on the table more and acknowledge more, because what happens in CFIUS is it becomes this a sandbox where the issue that isn't being addressed more broadly, everybody can just beat the heck out of it in the sandbox.
And so, Dan, you spent a lot of time in China. What if you're talking to Chinese officials or Chinese companies or Chinese friends, and you say, well, the U.S. government's concerns revolve around cyber or espionage, what do you hear from your Chinese counterparts?
Up until very recently, I would, in my experience, as an economist, usually doing think tank work or private sector work when I'm having those meetings, or sometimes in a track two setting where we're supposed to be able to speak frankly, up until virtually the present moment, the Chinese side was unwilling to engage on the topic of cyber. I gather that just in the past quarter, we've maybe turned a corner a little bit. We're at the early stage of being able to engage in a conversation. But I think cyber ultimately is going to be a very particular issue with connection to a very specific set of sectors that's going to continue to be problematic for a very long time to come and may almost get redlined in the U.S., as David, I think, suggested. But there are some other issues on the Chinese side that I think apply to almost all sectors and industries, which I think lend themselves to more opportunity to try to find a resolution of concerns. And the one that comes most immediately to my mind is the presence or absence of competition policy in the Chinese economy. Whether Chinese regulators protect competition or they protect competitors, their firms in the game. And that could become an issue in consumer electronics as easily as it could be an issue in steel or avionics or anything else. There are a bunch of efforts underway between the United States and other Pacific economies and now with the European Union to think about a next generation set of standards on things like competition analysis, how we think about that, so that when cross-border investments happen, that doesn't trip firms up in a new way. Unlike trade, we don't have a WTO for international investment, actually. It's all done with a set of clubby rules maintained by the OECD. It's probably time to start thinking about what the next generation set of rules for cross-border investment should be. And it's very much, I think, going to get to the heart of things like competition policy and hopefully make some progress there, whereas the nature of cyber I don't see a time anytime soon when we sort of transcend the problems associated with our critical telecom infrastructure and get to the point where it'll be normal. It'll be a normal industry.
I mean, one of the things that struck me about Dr. Gao's comment was that he said he was surprised.
Okay.
And so, I mean, my firm makes investments. Anybody that makes investments wants predictability. When we go into investment, we want to have a high degree of confidence that we can execute the transaction, that we can get regulatory approval, and that'll all happen in a timely fashion. In your view, any of your view, Michelle, you were on the inside for a lot of these transactions. Do you think that there's sufficient clarity if Chinese firms get good advisors on which transactions can get approved and which transactions won't get approved?
I mean, there's never going to be enough clarity to satisfy the investor community. I mean, you know, you want black and white, and it's never going to happen that way. But there's certainly the opportunity to ask questions, to have conversations with the CFIUS folks before you ever get to a filing, to bring in advisors who are looking at the political risk, not just doing the financing, and ask if you spend enough, do the due diligence on the regulatory side that gets done on the financial side. You can have a good sense of what the risks really are and avoid some of these.
But there are some transactions where there's, I wouldn't call it zero, but very modest. So, for example, my firm sold AMC movie theaters to a Chinese company. It was the largest Chinese acquisition of the U.S. We told them, you're not going to have CFIUS issues. If you do certain things right, you won't have any political issues. And the chairman of that firm was very enlightened. He went and met with the governor of Kansas, where the headquarters is, the mayor of the city, did a lot of outreach, which frankly are good business practices, and the transaction sailed through. So there are cases, aren't there, where transactions will sail through, there's not going to be any problems, right?
Yeah, and a big part of, to the earlier point about Chinese investors understanding the atmosphere here, you have to be willing to put in that sort of effort to talk to the constituencies in the U.S., not just put in a regulatory filing. And I think that's sometimes comes as a surprise to Chinese investors that they do need to go meet the mayor, and they have to have some messaging for the U.S. employees about why this is going to be good for them. We worked with Complete Genomics on that transaction, and the BGI Shenzhen, the
this genomic, was a what sector? Was this?
Genomic research. So
I'm sorry.
Human genome research.
Human genome. Oh, so a Chinese company invested in a U.S.
equipment maker in the industry. And you know,
no problems.
Well, when you first start thinking about it, human genome research sounds kind of scary, right? I mean, it's easy to turn that into a science fiction type fear campaign. So we said this could happen. You know, if there was a competing bidder, and so we knew that it could easily be a good tactic to try to disrupt the deal would be, let's you know raise all sorts of concerns about human genome research because no one really understands that. But going into the announcement, we're very transparent about the company's work, about their partnerships in the U.S., the good work they do towards global health outcomes, and just really being very forward-leaning in telling the story of BGI here so that when the competing bidder did try to raise concerns, they really didn't get any traction.
So let me just ask you one other question. Let's say a Chinese company comes to you and says, we're thinking about, let's pick a sector, not telecom, not technology, but let's take aerospace, okay? They come to you and they say, we want to pursue this investment in not sensitive aerospace, but something that's not going to cause national security concerns. What should we do? What's your checklist of things that a smart Chinese investor should do to reduce political reputation, media risk?
Well, it really requires taking a broad view, not just looking at the specifics of the transaction, but all of the things that are swirling around it. Yes, the specifics have to work, and there has to not really be a national security risk. And the parties to the transaction, their reputations will matter. But everybody who's a stakeholder, what are the employees going to need to hear? Is it unionized? Is there a union that's going to try to use this transaction to as leverage in a negotiation? What else is going on in that sector in the U.S. that is part of the policy debate? What will the mayor and the governor think, and can they help help with when there are doubts expressed in Washington? So it's really starting with a very narrow view, a very targeted look at the actual transaction, and then broadening out the lens to look at all the different stakeholders and just the atmosphere at that time in the U.S. and what media angles you might be exposing yourself to.
Dan?
Yeah, I think probably many people here may realize, but maybe not everybody does. Not every nation has the same template for reviewing inward investments. The United States is a little bit rare in that we are only looking at very narrowly defined national security concerns. We're not looking at a broader set of concerns, actually. Now, David, your AMC Wanda deal, you know, there were some losers from that. The losers were AMC Theaters competitors, American competitors, that would just as well not see their competitor better capitalized mm-hmm. by the up-and-coming movie theater market in the world to be their competitor in their backyard, right? Likewise with Complete Genomics competitors. If we had the same system that Canada or Australia do, then they would be admitted to the discussion. AMC's competitors would say, we don't think it's in the net interest of the United right. States to have this Chinese firm taking over our competitors.
Right. So
we think it would be better off for us if we
did. Our review process is actually very narrow.
It's actually quite
it's
narrow.
Only so, national security.
So when the Chinese side has a big gripe with us about whether we are open and whether our system is functioning fairly, they are arguing about whether we're stretching the definition of what's national security. But it's not really a question in almost all cases that we're arguing that, you know, labor interests would rather not have Chinese here or something other that doesn't fall under the narrowly defined security cone.
And Dan, last year we had how much Chinese investment in the United States?
We had close to $6.5 billion by our count.
$6.5 billion. And in 5 years, what's your best guess as how much we'll have?
We've projected for 2020, I'll tell you that,
okay.
Numbers from 150 to, well, total stock number of 150 to 400 billion.
Okay,
we have a total stock today of about 20, 25 billion.
20, 25. So what you're saying, it's 2013 now. In 7 years, we're going to have seven times, up to 10 times the amount of investment in
yeah, that's at least another $130 billion worth of deals. So divide that by seven to get the average growth. You know, $20 billion a year on average now to 2020.
Okay.
Still not a huge number. Australia sees that today already in a typical year or more.
They see $20 billion a year.
Or more.
Or
because
more.
They are characterized by big natural resource deals. We don't think of America as being that country, but guess what? With shale gas and other unconventional O&G going the way it is, that is this economy. So there's the potential for those. And as you know, Unocal would have been 14, 15 billion, 16 billion all by itself.
Energy is really the sector that proves the point about being open to investment. I mean, you would think that could easily fall into the sensitive category, just like critical infrastructure or telecom, but it hasn't. I mean, we've seen a lot of, you know, Sinopec Nexen get approved. We've seen Sinopec doing joint things with Devon Energy. I mean, there's a lot
right.
going on in the energy sector.
Yeah, the Sinopec Nexen deal was $15 billion on its own, and mostly in Canada,
yep.
but there was a large portion here. Sinopec has a deal, Sinochem has a deal right now, all in the billions. I wanted to go back to something, Dave, that Dan was saying, and it goes to a comment that I think Dr. Gao made about the minority. To Dan's point, we are about protecting the minority on the investment side also. It truly is the most narrow case where we take action, and our government takes action. And so it comes back to for every one deal that has an issue, there are five that get approved, and there are 10, 15, 20 that never even have to go through CFIUS.
Right.
So the vast majority of these transactions, it's not just that we're somewhat open, we're completely open. And the minority that are difficult shouldn't muddy the waters with respect to the overall picture. And I would say even for those a few transactions that have received attention, and the press has been somewhat of a challenge you mentioned A123 Wangsheng. We did that transaction. Genomics was at the same time. I think those are actually the perfect case studies for to have confidence in the U.S. market, because both of those cases were cases that involved assets that were politically sensitive. Both of them actually had rival companies out there that were affirmatively trying to generate political controversy and public controversy. And both of them got through CFIUS, and while there were some questions from Congress, it wasn't Dubai Ports again, it wasn't CNOOC Unocal. In fact, what you largely saw was that there were some perspectives on the extreme where, for political purposes, some particular members raised some issues. But for the most part, people on the Hill just wanted to be educated. And once you're able to educate them and explain that there really were no national security issues, and that it went through a full scrub by the U.S. government on the executive branch side, and here's why the transactions were good for the United States, they were good. And I think that is a very positive message that can be carried back to investors from all countries, but in particular from China.
Let me ask you this. In the 80s, Japanese companies had a very difficult time. Actually, a lot of the original statutes that are on the books that protect certain industries, the telecom, the aviation, the shipping industry, are from the late 1910s, right after World War I, where the Navy, in its wisdom, said, we need to protect U.S. industry from the next country with whom we're going to have war. That's the U.K. And so they passed a law that limits the amount of foreign investment in shipping, in broadcasting. At that time, the U.K., British Marconi, dominated U.S. radio, and also in aviation, because the British, at that point, dominated the aviation world. So sometimes governments get it wrong. It seems like we haven't really had a war with the UK. But Japan had a lot of trouble, and now Japanese companies really are part of the fabric of US economy, no problems really. Are there cultural issues from your experience that Chinese investors have that are unique or more difficult than other investors when they pursue acquisitions or make acquisitions and then have to run the companies?
I don't think you can paint one picture on that. I think it varies from company to company. You can't say all Chinese state-owned enterprises operate the same way and with the same level of sophistication. You can't say all Chinese private companies operate the same way. It is what you would expect in any economy that is growing, that is starting to look out. You have different levels of sophistication, both in terms of how they're approaching the investment, but also how they operate. And we've had transactions where you would think, given who the investor was and how international they were, that it would be smoother for them, and it wouldn't be so, they wouldn't have such a hard time understanding why some things were happening in the United States, but they were. And we've had other transactions where they've involved smaller provincial entities, which if you had a bias going in, you might think that they were less sophisticated or accustomed to how you would operate here, and it went very smoothly with them. Mm-hmm. And so I, the lessons I draw from that is you can't necessarily paint with one brush across.
And do you want to add any perspective from a cultural perspective?
The other difference, of course, is that over the decades, the Japanese have built so many factories in the U.S. and are such large employers in the U.S. now, and their economy's not growing, so no one sees them as a rising threat to the U.S. economy. So the bigger picture, I mean, I agree completely on the company-by-company level of understanding and expectations for the process, but the larger narrative that Chinese investment is playing into in the U.S. mentality is just so unique in that, you know, the public, I mean, there was a poll last year that the only country that the U.S. was more afraid of than China was Iran. The public understanding and fear is something that I think
Was that a poll of the policymakers or a poll of the public?
that was the public, but you might find the same thing among policymakers, you're right. And I think we can't underestimate that.
By our count, the way we're counting the about 700 deals, Chinese deals in America since 2000 that we've been able to identify, we can see about 32,000 U.S. jobs associated with that investment.
Right.
Japanese affiliate-related employment in America today, 700,000.
700,000, right.
700,000 Americans directly working for Japanese invested firms in the U.S. And so naturally, we want to look at the Japanese antecedent and see whether China can go up that same curve. That's a really significant amount of employment opportunity.
But there are differences, then we look at
We naturally look for the similarities and differences. Here are a couple other things. The colleagues up here have noted most of what matters. Let me add two more things. First of all, what we would call the liability of home authoritarianism. The fact that these Chinese firms are coming from a home regulatory environment, which is not legally driven the same way ours is, means that their know-how, what it means to comply with basic, mundane, local regulations, accounting standards, these sorts of things, is just not as sophisticated as when Japanese firms came here. When Japanese firms started coming to America in the 80s, we were on a totally the same level in terms of per capita income. These Chinese firms are coming from a market which is decades away from being regulated the same way. Several Chinese companies that have gone abroad have already discovered that once they leave their home court advantage, they can get into a lot of trouble. China Aviation Oil in Singapore running up $500 million worth of derivative liabilities. All the NASDAQ listed companies in America that have run into regulatory trouble, for example. Secondly, Japanese firms came here bringing their brands and their technological edge. They had learned to manufacture better, smarter, more high tech than we could. And so they brought something to the U.S. market that had long-standing, enduring value. Chinese firms are bringing the fact that they, back at home, have low-cost labor. But their low-cost labor advantages are eroding very quickly. I won't go into the details of what that means for how they will behave differently once they get here, but it's not going to be so stable, quite likely, as the experience we've had with Japanese firms that were willing to take a decade or more to kind of bring themselves into focus to the U.S. consumer.
So we have some questions coming in from the audience. So keep them coming. But here's the first one. It's pretty cool. They tweet these, or I don't know. It's pretty incredible.
It's magic. It's magic. It just shows up.
Pretty soon you're gonna have something in your car that tells you where you can go. So the question is, what about, this is from Raymond Lee at NYU, who's in the audience, Chinese capital flight, meaning Chinese individuals, presumably wealthy individuals, who are taking money out of the United States, presumably for concerns.
Probably the
about,
other way, David. I wonder, is it from the U.S. or from China?
From China.
From China to the United States. Did I say the opposite?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was just so mesmerized by the technology. So let me just start that over. Raymond Lee from Harvard. Okay. Chinese capital flight coming from China to the United States because of concerns of Chinese individuals or companies about security, stability, safety. Are you seeing that? Is that a growing trend? What do you have to say about that? I hope I didn't mess up the question, Mr. Lee.
I'll offer my view, and Dan and Michelle, you may have additional or supplemental thoughts. I think what we are seeing is the natural evolution of businesses as well as personal capital grow through a domestic economy that is starting to slow down, and naturally the next progression is to look out. And if you're looking out and you're an investor, you look for certain things. One of the things you look at is how safe is the political environment? How much certainty are you going to have? What's the economy like? Well, the largest economy in the world, which is the safest to invest in, is the United States. And so I don't know, and you guys have maybe additional thoughts on how much of it is driven by concerns about security or stability in China, and how much of it is really just a natural evolution that, you know, once you reach a certain level of growth domestically, you're going to start looking abroad, and we have a very attractive economy to invest in.
You know, I would totally agree. There's some amount of capital flight in the classic sense going on, no doubt about it. But the vast bulk of what we're seeing, what we're talking about, doesn't need that explanation. Good business sense is more than enough to describe what's occurring. Chinese manufacturers have about 70% of the U.S. apparel market as exporters, right? 70% of all the apparel we consume here comes from China. That's amazing, right? But it's all based on labor cost in China that is eroding quickly. If they want to continue to have that commanding position in the American economy, then they need to have a brand here. They need to have retail here. They need to have a relationship to the American consumer that will allow them to keep that market share long after dollar an hour factory wages are dead and gone, which they are in most of coastal China already today. So this makes, you can, using just perfect business 101 sense, explain the vast bulk of what we see happening.
Dan, we have another very good question from Johns Hopkins, which is about Chinese investment in Africa. And President Xi apparently recently said that there's about $30 billion of Chinese investment in Africa, which more than in the U.S., and it's growing faster. And the question is that investment squeezing out American or other investment that would otherwise flow to Africa, in your view? Hmm. And what's the future of Chinese investment in sub-Saharan Africa?
Hmm. Trying to sort out Chinese investment in Africa is even more difficult than the U.S. because the data there really is totally unreliable. All we officially have for China to Africa, is what's listed as going directly to Africa. The vast majority of Chinese investment to Africa goes to Hong Kong first, or BVI or Caymans, and then goes on. It may or may not actually be showing up. But I will say this: Africa is so scandalously underinvested as a place on Earth that China could take half of its foreign exchange reserves and put it into Africa, and there would still be plenty of good opportunities for American investors. Yeah. In fact, I dare say there would be more and better opportunities for American investors.
I agree with that. Our firm just started investing in Africa. We've done one investment, and we have another one in the pipeline. But we're the only firm of our type that operates in sub-Saharan Africa, and so I agree with you. For David or for any of you, there was recently a case involving a Chinese company that invested in a very small company in Nevada. And I forget, it was in the solar space, is that?
No, mining.
Gold mining, plants. Okay. And that transaction was completed, but the U.S. government actually made a decision that the Chinese company not only couldn't pursue it, but they had to divest. What was going on there? What were the issues? Maybe you could tell the audience about that.
That's the get out the map test that CFIUS applies. There have been a couple of transactions that are similar to that. There was also the Rawls case in Northern Oregon that were wind farms. The issues in both that and the mining case, and there have been two mining cases, one in 2009 where the transaction didn't go through, and one most recently within the last year where CFIUS identified it, specifically the Department of Defense identified it, forced a filing, and the transaction had been completed 2 or 3 years ago, and they forced a divestment. The issues in both of those cases related to what the Department of Defense calls persistent co-location. We commonly refer to it as proximity, and you can define proximity very, very broadly, meaning a couple hundred miles potentially, or less, within range of U.S. military installations where our military and perhaps other parts of the government do sophisticated systems and weapons testing. And if you're acquiring assets near in proximity to those types of facilities, you can do things like surveil them. And if you acquire the assets, meaning you're acquiring a business, then you're subject to CFIUS jurisdiction, and the U.S. government then actually has a tool to try to keep the investor away. And that's what the Nevada cases were all about. The Fallon Naval Air Station, which is sort of in central north Nevada, is where Top Gun is, as well as some other things.
I thought it was Miramar. Going back to my movie knowledge, that was Tom Cruise at Killing.
It was, Games, when, but, right. Yeah. When you were going through Top Gun, it was in Miramar.
Okay. Oh, it moved. Okay. It's now moved. You can see I'm dated. The technology is messing me up, too. But
yeah.
I just got this new video game called Pong, which is really good. It's got this.
So that's the issue in those cases.
So does that mean that a Chinese company really can't invest in a location near a military base?
It's not all military bases. Typically, the real challenge is that one of the sectors that is going to be very attractive going forward is the energy sector and natural resources. Those assets tend to be in the mid to western United States, places that are not heavily populated. Those places also happen to be pretty good places for the military to put things that they like to test. And that's the issue. You have a legitimate commercial interest maybe in natural resources, but those resources are closely located to
Let me ask you this.
This test ranges.
This is one I know you didn't want me to ask you, but I'll ask it anyway. So what if that same Chinese company, instead of buying that facility, what if they just rented it?
What if they just decided to open up their own gas station?
Yeah, what if they just, what if they decided to have a lemonade stand right there? What would the U.S.
There's
government do?
There's absolutely nothing that we can do about it other than, you know, our counterintelligence and counter-espionage capabilities include the ability to investigate and do things from a national security perspective. And so you use your typical authorities and tradecraft to address potential espionage risks. But there's nothing formal like CFIUS to come in and do something about that.
Okay, on the battery case, this was, a Chinese company investing in a electric battery. What's a national security concern associated with a battery? Is there one?
I think there's a broad concern about technology transfer. I think that the price of doing business for U.S. companies in China is that you have to hand over critical technology, and I think that's just it's a generalized anxiety rather than a specific national security risk, and that's why that all played out in the political arena, and yet the transaction was approved.
Well, but on that one, the batteries were already made in China.
They were.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. The other Asian countries have a leading technology edge. To the extent that they're made in the United States, they were not subject to any licensing requirements to go any place in the world other than denied parties. The lithium-ion battery technology in that case was as basic as it gets.
It was purely political opportunism.
Dan, let me ask you a question. Do you want to comment on that?
Just on that, I mean, and let's remember, the deal went through. Right, so the right conclusion was drawn about that. But let's also remember that before it went through, A123 was also involved in military application battery unit under contract with DOD that had to be divested, right, and hived off. And
we carved those out. Yes, we carved them out.
Got carved out, right? I mean, so yes, there may be a legitimate concern in the U.S. that defense-related contracts done by a new energy company, battery company like A123, be separated from the assets that are going to be acquired. But then the assets that are not a concern for national security reasons should be allowed to proceed. Exactly what happened.
Right,
it was messy, complicated, very expensive for the parties involved. I think there were four councils at least involved.
Which David thinks is not enough.
But it worked.
And I used to when I was a lawyer. But We have a few more minutes if there are other audience questions. I don't know if there are any more coming. I have a couple more questions. Huawei. So Huawei, everybody in the audience knows the company Huawei. You've heard of it? Yes. Okay. So it's a big telecom company. There's been a lot of controversy over Huawei investing in the United States. What's going on there? Who wants to take that one on?
By the way, there's controversy over them?
Well, I mean, look, I think probably Michelle and David are probably both more qualified than I am, but they're also smarter, and so they're not jumping up at this one. I've visited Huawei headquarters in Shenzhen. I've been through the plant, been through the facilities, met with the deputy chairman of the company, was very impressed.
Very impressive company.
They are a cutting-edge telecom company in the world today. They are able to deliver value to clients that I think is very compelling. But again, as we said before, there is this liability for them that they're not that they're a state company. Technically, they're a private firm, and I think they should be considered private. But they're coming from a place where one can't be entirely comfortable about the corporate governance relationship between the firm and government impulses and interests. And I think American telcos in China are being treated increasingly the same way now that government folks on both sides are becoming just aware of just how much we all are vulnerable to one another in an IT networked, internet-enabled world such as we live in.
I'll just say two things on that. I mean, we could take an hour and a half to talk about that one question, but the short answer is they operate in a sector that, apart from the defense industry, around the world is a sector that typically has a very close relationship with the home government. And that's just the reality of that sector. So that's a complexity. The second thing, and I'll see if you agree with this, is if you are somewhat controversial, maybe, just maybe, the right thing to do isn't to write an open letter to the United States government yeah. quoting Abraham Lincoln and asking for a full investigation.
So you thought that was not a good PR strategy?
I thought you wrote that.
Yeah.
All right, we have 3 minutes. Well, we're going to do, I'm going to call it a lightning round. Okay, you ready? One word answers. Okay, in 5 years, will it be easier or harder for Chinese companies to invest in the United States?
Easier.
Okay. This is a sensitive, non-sensitive dichotomy, okay? Auto parts, sensitive, non-sensitive?
Non-sensitive.
Non.
Okay. Energy?
Sensitive.
It depends.
Depends. You're disqualified from this question?
I have to say sensitive because parts of it are sensitive.
Okay, yeah. Let's get more specific. Oil?
Non-sensitive.
I can still say it depends.
Oh, I'm not going to ask you. Okay.
Really should be non-sensitive.
Okay. Nuclear. Well, it's a serious question. The U.S., the largest growth area for U.S. nuclear power manufacturers is China.
You know, lawyers typically charge per word.
Okay.
Sensitive. I'll say
sensitive. Okay.
Sensitive.
Yeah. If you like nuke, you should like China and nuke.
Okay. Will we have a Dubai ports-like blow-up in the next 5 years involving a Chinese company? A controversial front page, top of the news, CNN every day. Will we have that in the next 5 years?
No.
No.
Do you want the reason why?
No. Okay, Michelle?
I'll say yes, and I won't give you a reason.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, question for the audience.
What do you think we're going to have one?
I think we will. I think it's inevitable. Okay, I'm getting a notice to stop. Question for the audience, hands up or down? Has this been entertaining, hands up? Okay. Thank you very much.